In this week's Top Gear, the American dream car that still captures the imagination nearly 40 years on. Some bikes to help you tackle the new test for motorcyclists. And what many rally drivers dream of, special stages on the public roads. Hello and welcome to this week's Top Gear. We're at the National Motorcycle Museum, just outside Birmingham. Over 600 machines under one roof, which document, in a sense, the entire life cycle of this once great British industry, from its origins around the turn of the century to its demise or near demise in the early 80s. All the old nostalgic names are here, plus some that are not so familiar, because there were over 500 British motorcycle manufacturers. At one stage, they had over 95% of the world market. These bikes here represent one of the longest running British models, the famous Triumph Vertical Twin. That one, for example, was produced in 1938 with a 500cc engine. It became the standard bike for the Metropolitan Police. This is one of the last, the Triumph Bonneville 750cc, made by the Meriden Workers Cooperative before they collapsed. The good news is perhaps that Triumph are about to make a comeback. Now, most car models seem to change their shape every 3 or 4 years, at least the Japanese one do. But some seem to go on forever without any noticeable change in their external appearance. Jeremy Clarkson's been looking at three that have stood the test of time.
Much to everyone's surprise, in 1975, the XJS replaced the E-Type Jaguar. With its hard top, its automatic gearbox, and its near-silent engine, it was not a sports car then, and it's not a sports car now. There have been various derivations since 75, convertibles, a six-cylinder option, and most recently a thundering but nearly undrivable 6-litre. But through oil crises, privatisation, the V12 coupe has soldiered on.
Now, I know it's 15 feet long and the cabin's only this big, but when you're sitting here, cocooned by this huge transmission tunnel, titchy little windows running round, it feels like you're in your own little oldie-worldy nest. There are bits of the dashboard I'm not too fond of. The instrument binnacle looks like an awful hangover from the 70s, though I'm told it's to be replaced soon. And the last time I saw a knob like that, it was on a 1955 oven. Overall, though, it does have the charm of a lovely English country cottage. The wood looks like it's meant to be there. The leather feels right. A lot of manufacturers simply nail wood onto their most expensive models to make them different from the acrylan and plastic ones further down the range. That never works. It can never look as good as this. I just love it.
The engine's old too, fashioned from cast iron and so fabulously heavy, it's still a superb means of propulsion. And then there's the buttress styling. It was heavily criticised, but today, when all cars look the same, this is a refreshing change. And anyway, I've always rather liked it. It was always intended to be an effortless grand tourer. Indeed, in town, it can be persuaded to do 9 mpg.
You can buy more power, more sophistication, and a lot more fuel economy. But no car will do 1,000 miles of German Autobahn and a trip through the Alps in one day with such aplomb. You simply engage Waftmatic on the automatic gearbox, sit back and just watch the world go by.
There's no doubt that a replacement for the XJS would be lighter, faster and more spacious. But would it be better? Probably not. One car that isn't wearing so well as this old Leviathan is Volvo's even older 240. Now this can trace its roots back to a time when Harold Wilson was Prime Minister, when England won the World Cup, and when Rod Stewart was going out on his first date. It sells now only because of Volvo's image. It's perceived to be as safe and as sturdy as a Gloucestershire cottage, or a mansion in the case of the estate.
Well, 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 it seems to be true. All Cotswolds antique dealers do have Volvos. The thing is, every year Volvo makes some changes to their version of perpetual motion. This year I've got a bigger back window. This policy of evolution rather than revolution has resulted in it becoming quite a good value for money package. It now has power steering and central locking provided as standard, for instance. It also means that when a customer goes into the showroom for a new car, they're not just getting a newer one, they're actually getting a better one.
It's not quite as spacious in here as you might imagine. A Montego is just as commodious. And frankly, I find the whole thing a bit on the austere side. Dynamically, the Volvo 240 feels like it's a product of the 60s. With its rough engine and its live rear axle, it's only really happy at very slow speeds. Push it and the whole thing becomes coarse and a trifle wayward. Few, however, will push it. It's rather like a barber jacket, this, Hardly the most fashionable garment you can buy, but de rigueur nevertheless for the country set. It's nothing short of mind-blowing that this car was launched to compete with the Austin Cambridge, yet in 1990 it will outsell that technocrat, the Citroën XM. It can do that not only because of its image, but also because it's comparatively cheap. But a car doesn't have to be old-fashioned just because it's old. The original Audi Quattro is now 10, and it's every bit as fast and vibrant and exciting and expensive as it ever was. Designed originally to win rallies, it was the first performance car that successfully mated a powerful engine to full-time four-wheel drive. There have been more successful rally cars, but none has made such an impact. It really did change the face of rallying. Audi pulled out of the sport 4 years ago, and when they launched the new range of 80s, 90s and coupes, a lot of people thought the proper Quattro had died. Wrong. Truth be told, it nearly did. But such is the strength of feeling, particularly in Britain, that the venerable old warhorse was awarded a stay of execution. Better than that, Audi are still developing it.
It's powered now by a 220 horsepower, 20 valve engine, turbocharged, intercooled, 2.3 litres, five cylinders. Even with a catalytic converter, it still manages to get from 0 to 60 in 5.9 seconds. But there's an awful lot more to it than that.
The original four-wheel drive mechanicals, which split power evenly between the front and rear axles, have been replaced by a far more sophisticated system, which sends power to whichever axle sensors say is best able to handle it. The electronics extend inside with a gaudy instrument binnacle that I don't think is in keeping with a sensible four-seater supercar like this one. Then there's a facility for turning the anti-lock brakes off. Apparently, the car stops quicker on snow without ABS. If you want to keep going on snow, there's an electronically lockable differential. However, its use is somewhat negated by vast tyres, which work superbly well in normal conditions, but are quite useless in snow. They're just too wide. The Quattro may have earned its reputation in conditions like these, but the latest version is a real handful. You should have heard my language while we were filming this. Even so, the Quattro has yet to be beaten by any of the imitators which have come along in the past decade. None of them, indeed no car, covers ground so quickly and so safely. And the same applies even when it's pouring with rain. Even Audi's own attempt to topple it with the new S2 have, by all accounts, failed. Now, in this job, I'm forever being asked a question. Given all the money in the world, what car would I buy? You're looking at it.
Now, there can't be any corner of the motorcycling world that hasn't heard of the Isle of Man TT races. They've been taking place for over 80 years. They're a supreme test of a rider's skill and courage, and of a machine's handling and reliability. This Manx Norton 500, for example, represents in some measure the pinnacle of British road racing history because it's helped Norton to win more Isle of Man TT races than any other motorcycling mark. And the very special quality of these races resides in the fact they take place on public roads, closed, of course, for the duration of the race, that twist and wind around the island. Last month, Tony Mason went to another island, this time off the coast of Scotland, where very, very unusually, the public roads had been closed for a motorsports event.
The Tour of Mull is a three-day rally for the non-professionals in the sport, the club drivers. It's remarkable for its island location and for the fact that the organisers have managed to close public roads for the event, something which loftier bodies have not been able to achieve. Only 24 miles across, the island has 160 miles of roads and over a third of them are closed for the occasion. The car club that organises the event chose the island as a prime site for rallying in 1969. The roads in the enthusiast's native Lancashire were becoming far too crowded. Here, the only thing they had to contend with was the odd bread van.
It started because my family and I came for a holiday here that year and this rather strange idea occurred that the roads of Mull were suitable for an event that we had in mind. It seemed a rather far-fetched idea, but once we had suggested it, there was a lot of enthusiasm on the island, principally, I think, because it would generate some income, but also some interest in in a place where usually it's all peace and tranquility.
But when the RAC outlawed fast road rallies in 1987, it threatened the end of the Tour of Mull. There was only one answer: get rid of all the other traffic.
To close the roads was a monumental task. It was the sheer dedication of the Blackburn-based motor club that organises the rally that made it all possible. 3 years' work, a bill before the House of Lords and the House of Commons, two readings, the full support of the Strathclyde Regional Council and the signature of the Queen. But now it's happened, and no less than 100 entries have made their way here from all over Britain to compete.
Of course, to organise a rally on an island is a logistical feat in itself. A lone ferry from Oban has to work overtime, bringing over every last nut and bolt. And Tobermory's main garage has to open 24 hours a day, commandeered by drivers anxious to fettle their cars to the peak of perfection. The rally doesn't only take place on metal roads. It has its share of forest action, with stages every bit as difficult as some of those we've come to know on the mainland. Some of the cars we're more used to seeing on the road on classic rallies were revelling in the loose.
Road rallies used to always take place at night to avoid any incidents with other motorists. Modern international rallies, however, seem to have gone towards office hours and daylight. But the organisers of the Tour of Mull have stuck to their traditions, and the bumpy island roads are made even more tortuous because the entire tarmac sections take place during the hours of darkness.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1. It may be a Scottish island, but it could be Monte Carlo, San Remo, Corsica, or any other world-famous tarmac rally. With no fear of oncoming traffic, the drivers were giving it all they'd got. Closed roads are not totally unknown to British rally drivers. Part of the scene in Northern Ireland, the Channel Islands, and, as we all know, the Isle of Man. But here in Mull, it was something of an unknown quantity. Full speed practice is not allowed. Most of the crews had toddled round the roads the week before to get to know the lay of the land. That way, they were able to anticipate any obstacles, but there were still some who were inclined to overextend themselves. This incident could be excused, since the escort was already driving on a flat tyre at the time. But the marvellous thing about Mull is that they all come back for more.
How many years have you been doing this event?
21 now, Johnny. Everyone, done everyone.
And what appeals to you about it?
Oh, I think it's because I'm a bit daft. I always feel like a lot of other people, too old for this damn job, you know, but when I get going, I like it.
What is the magic of this rally?
The question is that. I don't know whether it's the water between the mainland or the people on the island or the atmosphere when you get here. I think it's probably the atmosphere when you get here.
Yes.
That's what I feel, you know. It's a fantastic place. You make a lot of friends. I just wish I could come back in summer when the weather's better.
But we may see you again next year as well.
Well, I was supposed to be retiring 3 years ago and I keep going back and doing Mull every year.
The promenade of the tiny town of Tobermory was totally taken over by the rally. But do the locals mind the incursion?
On the whole, all these people that come up, they're very mannerly and courteous. And I don't think the locals will have anything at all to complain about.
It's quite an invasion though, isn't it? Nearly doubles the population.
Yes, but that's not a bad thing, is it? It's really quite a good thing. We welcome anybody coming to the island any time. You don't have Highland hospitality here, you have Island hospitality, which is an entirely different thing.
Surprisingly, the police here are keen rally supporters. Several have come over from the mainland and seem to be taking an active role in proceedings.
Now, this is the first time I've actually seen racing numbers on a police car. Now, what's your role here?
The role of this car is that of filling the position of the first vehicle through the stretch of road affected by a closure, or the various closures as they roll on, and to signify to all officials, competitors and the public, the road is now closed to members of the public.
And you're not tempted to sort of go very quickly, are you? And have a go against the clock?
The temptation's here, yes.
Even the police agreed that the first closed road tour of Mull had been a model operation. There were no problems, and the overall standard of driving had been very high. Some of the favourites dropped out early, leaving local knowledge to shine through. Winner Andy Knight and his borrowed Nova was one of several islanders to do well on the 21st tour of Mull, the first to have closed roads. But what are the chances of more of this type of rallying elsewhere?
I think in the rest of the UK it's going to prove rather difficult. And personally I find that rather sad and slightly uncomfortable, being in the position where the tour of Mull is probably going to be the only one for some time. I'd prefer it not to be that way.
So, it looks as if any form of motorsport on closed public roads in Britain is going to remain a very rare event. Now, this handsome machine is a Brough Superior SS100 from the mid-30s, and with its 1,000cc matchless engine, it could very easily achieve the 100-mile-an-hour mark. And in 1935, when driving tests were first introduced, you could stroll down to your local post office, pay over a few shillings, and get a provisional licence and take one of these powerful machines onto the open road. It wasn't until 1960 the first glimmerings of concern began to emerge about motorcycle accidents, and an engine size limit was introduced for learner riders of 250cc's. 20-odd years later, and those regulations were toughened still further. A two-part test was introduced to encourage learner riders to gain some proficiency before going onto the open road, and the engine size limit was reduced still further to 125cc's. Now, on the 1st of December 1990, those regulations will be toughened still further. And Mark Forsyth has been looking at some of the machines that could help learner riders to cope with the new training procedure.
Okay then, Simon, when you're ready.
Out goes the old two-part motorcycle test, in comes the new one. As from December the 1st, all learners must undergo compulsory training and prove their competence at the end of it before they're allowed anywhere near a public road. Then, after more optional training, they can take the ministry test to obtain their full licence. This basic training will consist of classroom and road tuition, such as riding between cones in a car park, before candidates are allowed on the road with an instructor. One thing that will make life difficult is that if you buy a bike before passing the basic course, then you won't be allowed to ride it to the test centre. With a new bike, the dealer should deliver it for you, but if it's second-hand, you'd better find a friend with a van or trailer. Some centres can provide a package including bike hire or tuition, which could take you from the compulsory basic training right through to the full ministry test, effectively eliminating the need to buy a 125cc machine altogether.
Stay with me now. Stay with me. Slow down. Better than that clutch.
Of course, the only drawback of this idea is that the learner hasn't got a bike to practice on in their spare time. And as someone somewhere once said, practice really does make perfect. Now, if you're in the market for a 125, the choice of machinery can be pretty bewildering. So today we've taken the best sellers from three main categories, which are trail, sports and commuter, to see which best suits the learner and which a learner might keep once they'd obtain their full licence. Kawasaki's KDX125 is this year's trendy successor to the much-loved and much-stolen KMX125. If you're new to bikes, the full specification of the KDX will probably baffle you. However, if you're an enthusiastic 17-year-old, the square-section frame or its alloy rims or motocross-style bodywork will be highly significant. It's certainly a head-turner, from the team green paint job to the high-rise seating position. But that isn't the whole of the story. It's not the sheep in wolf's clothing it might appear. It's easy to ride on the test course, even if the front brake does need a lot of lever pressure to make it stop. It just feels well-balanced, agile and responsive. Off-road, it's brilliant. Fast steering and high-tech suspension make it easy for off-road incompetents to have fun in safety. Just as well, really. It's a doddle to ride, the riding position gives good visibility, but the seat height may be a problem for smaller riders. This training course is a cruel place to test the TZR125 Yamaha, because, strange as it may seem for a learner bike, it is very difficult to ride slowly. A bike for experienced learners, if you like. The original TZR125s didn't have enough steering lock to go between the cones of the old Part 1 test, and this 1990 version seems no different. And if that wasn't bad enough, the clutch on this particular model was grabby and unpredictable. Not a good bike to take your test on. It's better in town, but it's untouchable in its class on the open road, despite not having much power below 7,000 RPM. Handling and braking are its forte. The CG125 Honda, virtually unchanged for as long as someone with a memory as bad as mine can remember. The whole bike's as simple as its specification. You don't get a rev counter because you don't need one, and likewise, cheaper to produce drum brakes rather than trendier discs. The riding position is tailored for ease of operation, visibility and comfort. The CG is really in its element in town. It'll buzz away through its five gears fast enough to keep ahead of most of town traffic. Its fast steering really helps here as well. As far as economy goes, how does 100 miles per gallon grab you? The CG125 is the easiest of the bunch to ride and by far the most practical. For this reason, it's an ideal learner's bike.
Well, you've got those and you've got this ugly little chap, but don't rule the MZ out on account of its Eastern Bloc styling. It is crude, yes, but it's also cheap to maintain, reliable, robust, but perhaps most importantly, as far as a learner's concerned, very, very easy to ride. In actual fact, they're not as cheap as they used to be. They're 40% more now, but blame the recent unification of Germany for that one. Comparatively, they are still cheap. So if you couldn't give a damn about street credibility, the MZ looks like being the sensible choice. And as MZ don't practice the usual headless chicken new model every year policy of the Japanese, they're less likely to become obsolete, and the price at resale time reflects this.
Now, some of the most legendary machines in this museum bear the name Vincent HRD. The young Philip Vincent bought the HRD company back in 1928 for just £400. He'd already designed his first bike while still at school, at Harrow, no less. I wonder what his parents thought of that. This is one of the most famous machines he turned out, the Vincent B-Series Rapide, with a 1,000cc V-twin engine, described as having a colossal performance. 2 years later, in 1949, he refined it in the shape of the Black Shadow here, again with a 1,000cc V-twin engine, capable of doing 125 miles an hour on the road. Now, sadly, Vincent stopped production in 1955, but the mystique, if you like, still rings around the world. Now, one American car whose reputation still rings around the world is the Chevrolet Corvette. Becky Adam took a few of them for a spin.
Of these famous fiberglass sports cars. It was the start of a series of models, each of which fitted perfectly in with the style of their times. Surprisingly, this 54 wasn't instantly popular, but now, of course, you can't buy one for love nor money.
These, the earliest Corvettes, were powered by six-cylinder engines, while most of their European rivals were still only running on four, the exception being the classic Jaguar XK120, which also ran on six. In 1955, the small block Chevy V8 arrived, and they never looked back.
Well, she got her daddy's car, and she cruised through the hamburger stand now. Seems she forgot all about the library, like she told her old man now. With the radio blasting, goes cruising just as fast.
This 59 model, probably the most popular of all Corvettes, was styled by Harley Earl and was, quite literally, the star of Route 66, a 50-minute TV series that ran for 116 episodes. It inspired a generation of post-war viewers to throw caution to the wind and buy themselves a real sports car, as American as Hollywood and hash browns.
Riding along in my automobile,
my baby beside me. The 1963 Corvette Stingray was available as a convertible or fastback coupe, which had a stylish but impractical split rear window. Almost everything was new. The wraparound windshield had gone and the chassis had been redesigned, although the trusty V8 remained. Riding along in my automobile, I was anxious to tell her the way I feel. So I told her softly and sincere, and she leaned and whispered in my ear. As the swinging 60s drew to a close, the car kept pace with changing fashions. They might have got me to wear a headscarf, but these? No way. The 400 bhp kick from this 7-litre big block 427 certainly doesn't need the help of platform shoes. It happened on the strip where the road is wide. Two cool shorts standing side by side. Yeah, a fuel-injected Stingray and a 430.